Welcome to Scandinavia.
Thank you.
You came directly from Kabul.
Yes.
Tell me, you've been there for 7 years now. How did you end up there in the first place?
Well, I originally went in 2008. I went there to train and mentor Afghan defense attorneys with a program that was funded by the U.S. Department of State. To be honest, I really went there for the money because it was making significantly more than what I had been making as a U.S. attorney at the time. And so that's what got me in Afghanistan in 2008.
And what did you know about Afghanistan? I mean, were you familiar with the country?
No, I wasn't familiar with Afghanistan at all. In fact, I had never left the U.S. until 2008. Afghanistan was the first country that I ever traveled to out of the U.S. So I was very fresh, and I didn't know a lot.
Were you anxious? I mean, it can be a dangerous place.
Yeah, it can be. I was anxious. You know, I just didn't know what to expect. And obviously, when you watch the news or when you hear about Afghanistan, it's not in a very positive light. So, of course, I was a little concerned, but I was very curious about how the country was.
Did they warn you, like, you should be careful, or...?
Well, you know, when I went there in 08, they had this training that I was sent through. And it's very Manchurian candidate-ish, where they show you, there's one point at the training for about 4 hours where they showed us videos of things and people that had been blown up, presumably in Afghanistan. And so the training was ridiculous, but that's what they sort of showed us. You know, so literally when I went to Afghanistan, I really felt like I was going to, you know, walk off the airplane and a suicide bomber was gonna try to come up to me and give me a hug. So it was very terrifying at first.
This is, I mean, Afghan law, that's very much a man's world, is my impression anyway. How do you find your place there?
Well, I mean, you know, I am who I am. And, you know, now I work independently. So I have an independent law firm that I work from in Afghanistan. And so I just, you know, I'm there to represent my clients. I'm there to, you know, be their lawyer. So I just do what I do, and I don't really ask for their permission to give me a place.
Do you wear a headscarf? Do you?
No.
Why is that?
You know, I don't do it to be disrespectful. It's just not my thing, you know. And I always felt like if I'm going to practice law in Afghanistan, then I need to be who I am. And that's not what I do, and so that's why I don't do it.
Do they, I mean, the people you deal with, do they respect that, or can it be a problem for you?
Well, it hasn't been a problem for me. You know, nothing where anyone has brought it to me, and I don't allow for it to be a problem, to be honest.
You have different. I mean, you're doing all kinds of cases. I mean, you don't. You're not a human rights activist. You're a traditional lawyer taking all kinds of cases. Can you tell us a bit about that? What kind of clients you choose?
Well, my clients, I'm an international litigator, and so I love to go to court in all different countries. Afghanistan is obviously a place I go to court a lot. And so my clients consist of a lot of companies that I represent around the world. I represent several embassies and ambassadors in Afghanistan. I represent foreigners for different legal or criminal offenses in Afghanistan and beyond. And I also represent a huge portion of human rights clients, mostly women and children. And that's about 30% of my work. And I do that work pro bono.
And so the other clients are bread and butter, and then you have...
Right, exactly.
Pro bono clients as well.
Right, and I have those pro bono clients are all around the world. And so now, thanks to what has started in Afghanistan, you know, I have clients on every continent except for Antarctica, which I would love to get a client in Antarctica to just check that box. you know, my sort of my pro bono human rights clients, those are really, you know, my heart and soul. And so I fund that all myself through my bread and butter clients.
When you work on a case, can you like Gunde was telling us about earlier that he visualizes, you know, he visualizes how it will end. I mean, if it's a competition or if it's making a world hit or whatever, can you visualize as well?
I definitely
the result.
Do. I was listening, and I totally understand that. I definitely, you know, I feel like litigation is really an art. It's a craft. You know, just like performing as an artist, just like being an athlete, I think it's very artistic to me. And so I do definitely visualize, you know, how I'm going to play things out in court and winning in court. I think that's very important. Mm. Positive thinking.
Yeah.
Mm. How corrupt is that? Is law in Afghanistan?
Well, Afghanistan is one of the most corrupt countries in the world. It sort of volleys between Somalia, North Korea, and Afghanistan for the top three spot. However, I have found that if you use the laws in the ways that they're intended to be used, then you can be successful. And I find that in Afghanistan, as well as other countries, that people are very ignorant to the law. They don't know that the laws are there for them. They don't know that the laws exist. And they often allow themselves to be bullied into, unfortunately, having cultural practices supersede the law. And so my job is to stand up for my clients, to not allow for them to be bullied, and to use the laws in the ways that they're meant to be used, which is to protect my clients and to protect all of us.
Do you ever, have they ever tried to bribe you? Have you experienced that?
They have tried to bribe me, and it's actually funny because, you know, they kind of stop now because I don't pay bribes. And so I remember the last time they usually try to bribe through my translators. And so one of the judges was like, you know, do Americans accept bribes? And my translator told him, not this one.
You made quite a lot of headlines internationally, especially with one case, and it was a 6-year-old girl, and she's called Nagma.